IVM.
Hi.
You're
listening to
IVM
Daily.
Hello and welcome to IVM Daily. I'm Swati and today's show is dedicated to a film director. A director who created many noteworthy films such as Darmiya, Rudali, Daman. Yes, I'm talking about Kalpana Lajmi, who is no more in this world physically, but her work and her ideas would continue to be discussed on various platforms. And I'm going to talk about her distinct films and life with someone who worked very closely with Kalpana Lajmi. Sunanth Mitra started working as a clapper boy on her film Darmiya and later became her chief assistant director. Sunanth was also the co-writer of Chingari, Kalpana Lajmi's last film. So, Sunanth, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much.
So, you've spent a lot of time with Kalpana Lajmi and you know her from close quarters. So, I would want to ask you, how do you remember her as a director? How would you describe Kalpana Lajmi as a director?
See, when I joined her, I came to the city of Bombay from Kolkata in 1996.
Okay.
And all my things were lost. Everything was stolen.
Achha.
So I was like, I'm narrating this incident to let you know about the kind of heart she had and Dr. Hazarika had.
Hmm.
So I lost everything and I was spending my days in Andheri station because I never knew anybody in the city.
Right.
So one day when the car was entering the Natra studio gate to your office, so I just waved at Dr. Hazarika, who rolled the glasses down, and I said, "Dada, I'm Bangali," which means I'm a Bengali.
Mm-hmm.
"And I'm looking for work here. I lost everything." So he said, "Come in." And that's how I was absorbed as a clapper boy.
Okay.
So that is the kind of heart she and Bhupendra always had. And then in Darmiya, I started working over there and there were chief assistants, second assistants, there were associates who finally couldn't be with her till the end of the film. There was some reason or the other.
Mm-hmm.
Because they got better opportunities or like maybe there was some reason.
Mm-hmm.
And finally, I was lucky enough to get the opportunity to handle every aspect of the film. So, one day when I asked her, "Ma'am, do you think that I'll be able to be a good filmmaker?"
Okay.
So, he said, "First you have to be a..." She said that exactly the filmmaking techniques you can learn in one film.
Mm-hmm.
But to make a good film, you have to be a good person first.
Right.
So, okay, so as a filmmaker, she was much beyond her time. Hmm. Darmiya was a film in which I joined her, which was a true story, and it was fictionalized on Tikku.
Right.
So it was a story of a eunuch born in a family of an actress.
Yes,
of repute.
Aging actress.
And, later on, she gets faded, actually.
Hmm.
So at that time in 1996, making a film on the eunuchs was a very, very daring act because nobody ever touched that subject in Hindi cinema earlier.
Absolutely.
As far as I can remember.
Yes, yes.
So that kind of a potential, that kind of a strength, that kind of a courage, that kind of an honesty she had as a filmmaker. She used to be blunt on the face till the time she breathed her last.
Hmm.
Even in Daman, where it talks about Ravina Tandon won the National Award for as the best actress. Even in Daman, she showed the issue of domestic violence, which never was touched very seriously. I mean, domestic violence was touched. Touched and go went in other commercial Hindi movies maybe, but making it an issue and then making a film on that was really a brave and courageous act on her part.
Yeah.
Okay, so her filmmaking was more courageous. Her filmmaking may not have been accepted at that time because the mindset of people was not as developed as today's generation.
Right.
But however, they were brave, they were courageous, and they were blunt on the face.
Absolutely. And like you're saying, that her body of work was, acutely focused on gender and women. But she was reluctant to label herself as a feminist director, I read in many interviews. So could you elaborate on that? Because she was one of the early feminist voices in Hindi cinema and still she was not so keen on, to be talked about as a feminist director. What could be the reason for that?
No. She was much beyond. I mean, she was definitely not a feminist. No. She tried to explore issues about women which were not talked about. That doesn't mean that in personal life she becomes a feminist. She always treated us all as equals. Even with men, she was very popular. She had many male friends.
Right.
And whom she used to share things with. You imagine about me. I am a man, and I have been with her for the last 22 years. So why will she? She would have kept a woman rather to assist her, or like to do her work, or to be with her, or to understand her. But however, she shared most of the things with me. Why? If she was a feminist, would she have done this? She wouldn't have. While writing the book on Dr. Bhupen Hazarika, the first person was, she said, remember, you are going to be my co-writer on this.
Okay.
So we wrote the book for 2 years. She could have easily chosen a woman instead of me. Isn't it? So in personal life, if you delve into her personal life, she was not at all a feminist. She raised, she had handpicked issues that addresses women. Issues that talk about women. Because today's conscious world, at that time, it was not so conscious. Today we are talking about women, 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 everybody. Even men are talking about women. Women are talking about women. Empowerment of women. And now everybody is like, you know, okay, women are equal to men. That's the most stupid thing. Women are more powerful than men.
Okay.
Okay. So, so she never, as a, she never, never behaved like a feminist in the personal life. No.
So, okay, because you've been with her in her cinematic journey and you saw her working and you worked with her very closely. So, tell us about her, you know, idea about casting her actors. How did she used to cast her actors or decide that who is going to play which role, and how would she agree, you know, to take a particular actor in a particular role? What was the process? What was her creative process of doing this?
Yeah, so what was her process of working was very, very logical. I would rather say it was a very chronological process. First, an idea was hatched. First, an idea was taken. Then it was developed into a story. Then it was fleshed out into a screenplay. And finally, there came the dialogues. Now, the characterizations also came in. Now, as the characterization came in, we would sit, rack our brains, and find out who can be the perfect character for this.
Okay.
This protagonist, or the male, or the female, or the supporting actors. And thereafter, we'll proceed, send a feeler to the actors, proceed in the most formal way. And at times, even actresses like Ravina, who came forward for the man and said, I would love to do the role. Okay, Sushmita. When we approached her, she immediately liked the script and said, yes, I am on.
Okay.
And they had also extended their support and cooperation towards making of these films, because these films are not very highly budgeted films. They were we made films in a very stipulated budget frame and a very stipulated time frame.
And that's what, so, because for these characters and for these roles, she picked up some very glamorous commercial faces like Ravina Tandon, Dimple Kapadia, and Sushmita Sen, who actually won, you know, Miss Universe contest. So.
The
thing is that her role and these faces are like really interesting choices. So that's what I wanted to understand, that how did she decide that she's going to choose these faces?
It all depended on the characterization size of role use. That as the character flew, she used to go, I used to go with her and narrate to them the exactly what the character is. And then thereafter, there was a rigorous workshop that used to happen with these people. They used to dedicate time for a workshop. They used to dedicate time for script ready. So making a small budget film is a much tougher thing than making a film with a budget that has got a lot of spaces.
Yeah.
Okay. But this was a very tough process. Ravina, we had almost a two-month workshop. With Sushmita Sen, Mithun Chakravarti also, we had a 2 to 3 months workshop.
Okay.
Okay. Workshop was very, very, I mean, essential part. And that's how they were been able to get into the skin of the characters and portray their characters so marvelously on screen.
Okay, so you mentioned about Bhupen Hazarika in your answer earlier. How would you describe her relationship with Bhupen Hazarika? Because it was a very different and unique relationship of, you know, almost four decades.
As far as I saw them, the relationship, if you go into the depth, is unfathomable. Absolutely unfathomable. She used to play the part of every woman in his life.
Okay.
She used to play the part of every woman in her, starting from a lady business manager to a mother, to a daughter, to a wife, to a girlfriend. Every part she played in his life. That was how the man was really, very lucky, Dr. Hazarika, who was also a creative genius and a versatile genius, a bard of Brahmaputra, I should say, that she was with him, that his life was much more organized. His life was much more onto the rails. His life was much more into synchronization. Okay, so that's how the role was of her. Though she had written a beautiful love story on the, in the book, but
okay,
it was only not a love story of two lovers.
Hmm.
Love story of two individuals who, one of them being the woman, took over in the later part and played every woman in the man's life.
Okay. So did you have a chance to speak to, because you met her and you used to meet her in her last days also when she was extremely unwell and she was not even able to make it to the release of the book also. What did she used to think about her entire life? Was she happy? Was she satisfied? What did she think about her whole life?
Before Bhupendra passed away, she was a very vibrant, a very fun-loving person with a lot of creativity like beaming out, you know.
Yeah.
But after Bhupendra left in 2011, she became a little mellowed down, which I could understand that it was a kind of a little bit of depression that was, she was going into. But finally she recovered from there also. Finally she recovered from there also because of Mr. Mahesh Bhatt, whom she used to treat as a cinematic guru.
Yeah.
And Mr. Sunil Razdan said that, why are you doing this? Like, you know, so that heartbreak is a gift, but self-pity is the poison. Why don't you write a book on the giant that you had in your life? Okay, on the person who was like internationally acclaimed because of his music, which preached about brotherhood. And that is when we started writing the book. And she was hoping to make a film. And we started writing the script also, the book also. And then after around a year back or so, HarperCollins came forward and said that we are going to publish it as a book. And we got a producer also to make it into a film.
Right.
So we wrote the script. We started writing the script and we are just halfway through when she left. She couldn't make it to the program. And that is the day I saw her most heartbroken.
Right.
On 8th of September. So she said that a lot of people are coming and this is my first book and I won't be able to be there. And the doctors didn't allow her. It's all for her good that she doesn't fall prey into the trap of any kind of an infection. So that was the day I saw her really, really very heartbroken because she was very, very expectant about releasing to be there in the release event rather. And after I met her last on this Saturday and the Saturday prior to that, and she said that do one thing, let's just work on the script.
Achha.
I said, okay, fine. And she said, read the foreword for me. So I read the entire foreword of the book and said, she said that, do you understand anything? I said, ma'am, I co-wrote the book with you. But then go, the entire structure of the script is ready. You start doing the beginning, at least like how to begin the film with.
Okay.
And I said, ma'am, I'll need around a week's time for this. She said, take a week's time, go, come next Saturday. And I went, and on Friday, I just gave a call to see whether Sunday's meeting is confirmed or not. And I find that for the last 3 days, she was lying in the ICU. She never wanted to die. She always wanted to live. She always wanted to live and make this film on Bhupen Hazarika and make a global film on Bhupen Hazarika.
Okay.
So this was the kind of person she was. Like, she's totally, what do I say, bubbling with positivity all the time.
Absolutely.
But she was in agony. She was in pain.
Yeah. So are you taking that project forward? Is there a plan to take that project forward?
I'm very much involved with the project, but however, the producer should take a decision. I mean, it depends entirely on him, and he will have to take a decision. If he wants to give me the responsibility of doing it, I will happily accept it, and I will put in my more than 100% into it. That's for sure.
Thank you so much, Sunand. Thank you so much for talking to us. Sunand Mitra had a rare opportunity to be associated with a director whose films would be remembered as a distinct text of female voice in Hindi cinema. On that note, I will say bye-bye, but stay tuned to IVM Podcasts. We are present on social media platforms everywhere, actually, Twitter, Instagram and Facebook. And of course, IVMPodcasts.com.
Every week a show where three people come together to tell you about stuff they like. A movie, a TV show, a book, and other stuff. Tune in every Monday on the IVM Podcast app to IVM Likes. Batman approves this message. Thank you, Batman.
Shunyavan Shunya one.
$1 billion acquisition. Another copycat startup got formed.
No, the tech world in India is surely moving double the speed of this voiceover.
Tune in to Shunya One every Tuesday to catch us talking to the smartest people we know on the IVM Podcast website, app, or wherever you get your podcasts from.